This is Thoughts Become Things. With each episode, we'll help you reach the highest creative potential that God has for you. With your host, a teacher, life coach, a dream coach, and motivational speaker, Jeremy Lopez.
Good everyone, and welcome to another exciting podcast of Thoughts Become Things. I'm Jeremy Lopez, and so glad, as always, you guys decided to join with me today. And I'll tell you, I love every week. I love every week that I'm able to have this opportunity to come and speak to you guys through the podcast, and, you know, really be able to bring hopefully fresh revelation, draw you closer into your own empowerment, letting you know you attract things by what you are, attracting things within your life. And I want to share you some things today that actually I believe will be really relevant for many of you, because I think a lot of you are wondering, as far as this law of attraction thing, exactly what do I do? Like, how do I attract? Well, I want to be able to speak to you guys today on the power of attraction, but I want to actually entitle this, How Do You Truly Authentically Attract? How do you truly authentically attract? And I said that because I want to talk to you about some life coaching sessions I've had recently. I remember speaking to a lady yesterday, and great woman of God, love her to pieces. I do sessions with her a whole lot. And some of the things that she was mentioning to me was, she's talking about, you know, I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to do this in my job. I feel like my sales are not up. I feel like this is not happening. You know, why can't I produce more in my job? Like, what's going on? I don't understand. I just can't seem to find myself attracting it. And so what I began to talk to her about is, I said, Tell me, how are you trying to attract? Now, I like that phrase, because people, when you ask people, how am I trying to attract? Most people, like her, begin to, you know, start off by saying, well, it's what I think. You know, I've been thinking positive. That's usually the number one key thing. I'm thinking positive. You know, I'm thinking good thoughts. I'm thinking about what things would look like. I'm thinking about having this. I'm thinking about driving in this car. I'm thinking about, you know, producing more sales for my job. And I get that, because a lot of times the first rule of thumb on law of attraction, according to Bible and everything, and other things within spirituality, deal with the power of thoughts, because thoughts become things, right? And that coin term, thoughts become things, is very powerful. It's been relevant in the sense of realizing it does work. However, there are a lot of missing components when it deals with thoughts become things, quote unquote, mentality, the buzzwords, because a lot of times we get so caught up in just what we think. And so one of the things I was sharing with her, and I said, let me explain this to you. I said, you know, so you're telling me that you've been thinking positive thoughts, you've been sort of visualizing, you know, from God's will, exactly what this would look like to be on top and be successful and be this and be that. And she said, absolutely. That's what I've been thinking all the time, and it's just not working for me, and I don't understand, because I know it works. It used to work for me all the time. And I said, well, first of all, let me tell you this. Everything in the universe needs an upgrade. Computers get an upgrade. I don't know about you guys, but I just had an update last night on my computer. I was about to close my Mac. All of a sudden it says, hey, there's an update here on this, you know, the OS here, you know, part of the Mac, you know, and I'm like, you know, because it takes so long to upgrade, and sometimes it's got your system has to reboot itself and restart the computer. But you know what? It is what it is, because you know what? The truth is, I want upgrades. I want to be able to always be faster. I want to be able to be more relevant. I always want to have the latest downloads on my computer, to where I'm not sort of, you know, backwoods, for lack of better words, you know, and have my computer being a dinosaur. I want to be able to keep up with everything that's fresh and new that they put out for the Mac. You know, love Apple. Let's give Apple a big plug here, because I'm a huge Apple fan. And so with that being said, you know, we like upgrades, we like changes, but one of the things we don't realize is, when it deals with law of attraction and the power of thought, you've got to begin to upgrade that. So in other words, what you think once worked for you in your life, that's great, but however, doesn't mean it's always going to work for you in the future. And I'll explain to you why. It doesn't mean that spiritual laws that God put in the kingdom, you know, just quit working. It doesn't mean spiritual laws of God's kingdom mean that, you know, well, it's getting old, it's been around for like, you know, 50 billion years. Hey, we need to upgrade now. You know, we need to sort of change it. What it says basically is the fact that you're growing. And I was ministering to someone prophetically earlier, and I put in the prophetic word, I mentioned about how God showed me to tell them, you know, that this is a season when this is happening, that's happening, and it's time to grow up. And all of a sudden it hit me. I'm like, Lord, are you saying they're immature? Are you saying, you know, they need to grow up, you know, like we do as kids? Hey, you need to grow up. You know, you're no longer a kid, you're 21 years old, you know? You should be on your own. That's not what we're talking about. It said, and so the prophetic word God continued, he said, things are beginning to grow upward, which means things are beginning to grow upward means that there's things changing, there's things shifting. And because things are shifting and changing as it grows upward, that means what happens is you've had a foundation built, right? And if you build a foundation, that means things are going to begin to go upward because what? You finally have your groundwork laid. Are you with me? Once your groundwork's laid, guess what? Then things can grow upward and you can begin to explode, bear forth fruit and everything else, right? And so once a groundwork's laid, then it's going to start going upward. And what that means in law of attraction is this. Once you begin to sort of set the stage for, hey, positive thinking, my thoughts now are like really in this train of new thought, where new thought meaning the fact of a new thought, new thinking, new ways of thinking, that might mean it's finally in this new thought reality, you know, so I'm able to think new thoughts now, so I'm training my mind. But what happens is, guess what? You're still going to be up for an upgrade in law of attraction. You're still going to be wanting to be able to upgrade within your life. And what that means for you is this, is once you begin to lay the foundation of your thoughts, once you begin to get the concept of your thoughts, don't think for a moment that your life is not going to change, because it will. And what that means for you is it means once the foundation of your mind is sort of renewing and renewed, we should say, because your mind nearly never gets renewed. It's always renewing, you know, having the mind of Christ. And so once it continues to renew, but yet there's enough to be renewed to where you can jumpstart on it, guess what? Your upgrade then is going to be sort of requiring you, the Spirit of God is going to require you a new upgrade, which means now you're going to have to begin to work on the inner, deeper parts of your soul and your body and the full totality of the triune being as well, of who you are. What that means is this. Once you get your thoughts down pat, something begins to happen. And that is, now I'm beginning to be challenged. Now I'm beginning to be convicted. Now I'm beginning to really, you know, see myself in the mirror. It's called the mirroring effect at a deeper level now. And what that means is life starts getting a little bit more scarier. And a lot of people don't realize. They say, I don't understand. I started thinking positive. I attracted this and this and this. All of a sudden, I feel like it just quit working with me. And I'm just start feeling things. I'm starting, you know, getting nervous and scared. And I start questioning God and questioning myself. And what have I done wrong? Well, the key thing is that it's not always about you've done something wrong. The problem with most people is they automatically go negative. And I do not understand for the life of me why everybody who always says to themselves, I don't understand why, you know, usually I feel like God hears me, all of a sudden, you know, God can't. What's wrong? You know, I feel like that, you know, God's always around me, all of a sudden I feel like he's not. What's wrong? It's hard for me to wrap my brain around why our minds automatically go to the negative. You know, what if it's something not wrong? What if it's something right? What if there's something actually radically changed to where it's not about what's been wrong? Maybe your time for an upgrade to where maybe what's been going on is you're doing something right. And so just because something changes, and just because you don't hear, or you don't see, or you don't, you know, smell or taste, or even spiritually discern, you know, stronger like you used to, doesn't mean something's always wrong. Now, sometimes, grant the fact, that can be the fact, but not most of the time, because a lot of times God says, hey, look, you know, I mean, you're being upgraded because you've been faithful in the small things. So if you've been faithful in the small things, I'm going to upgrade you to become faithful and rule over many things, which means your whole personality and the whole sort of, we'll say, molecular structure, spiritually speaking, of who you are has shifted to be what? A ruler of many things. And yet, all of a sudden, what happens is when your world begins to dry up because you no longer see the small things, your world begins to dry up because the things that you once mastered, they're now disappearing. They're sort of disintegrating. They're, you know, are being eradicated. Then all of a sudden, it's like, oh my God, God took everything away from me now. Well, guess what, folks? Don't think for a moment God will not take things away from you to establish a new order. The Bible makes it very clear that the old things pass away. So it's not about old things like just, hey, 5 years ago I did this. It's also old things that you've already mastered, old things that you've already accomplished, old things that a finish line, you know, guess what? Once you cross the finish line, folks, they don't say, okay, now go back and do it again. Okay, now do it again. Okay, do it again. You know, step 10 feet over on the other side of the finish line that you once was on and run across it again. Okay, go back 10 feet, now run across it again. See, we've got this mentality that God's going to use the same old stuff all the time. And he's not. Because if you, with your upgrade, that means you get a new boot, rebooting. Things become new. Old things passed away. Behold, I make all things new. So the newness is trying to kick into you, but you don't want to accept the newness. And so what that means for you is this. Is like I spoke to my friend yesterday, the client I had. And I said, here's your situation. I said, things that once worked for you, I said, it's not going to work for you anymore. God is not always going to gently just lead you from step to step and just one comfort to another. I said, in between comforts, in between stairs. I said, think of it this way. In between stairs, that means what? You have to lift your foot up. Think about it this way. If I'm on, let's say if there's 10 steps, I have a two-story home, beautiful two-story home, my family. And so if I'm going up the stairs, maybe to go to, I have different rooms in my house. We do for studies and we do for, meditation, prayer rooms. We'd have so many things in our home. So if I'm going upstairs and I'm on step 3 and I'm going to step 4, step 5, step 6, guess what? That means I'm going to have put some energy in my legs to lift my foot, lift my whole leg. For that matter, and put it up on the next step. Now, it might sound, hey, that's easy. I mean, hello, I can run up the stairs. Well, yeah, we can. The problem with that is, well, not the problem, but the situation is you're forgetting you've been autopilot to know, I just lift my legs and go. I just do it, And the key thing is you don't, in doing it, you're forgetting you're still, eluding energy to lift your leg up and put that foot on the next step. So there's still work involved. And in between that step, there's just air. When I lift my foot off a step, here's where people miss it. Even when you walk, when you lift your foot to take another step up, or you lift a foot a step, forward, guess what? There's nothing under at the moment but air. Think about that for a moment. So literally, your foot is going from being solid on something to being lifted up in the air with nothing under it, and then being able to set it back down again on a solid place. So if I'm going upstairs, that means I'm constantly going on solid to air, right? So in between the stairs, there's nothing. The place of nothingness. And the place of nothingness is what I usually refer to as the void. I refer to as the metamorphosis. I refer to it, as that cocoon. I refer to it to the nothingness because of the fact that is pure faith, right? Because you are on autopilot, not realizing your foot's on pure faith because there's nothing under it. But automatically it knows that my brain's going to tell my foot, but you're headed towards the right direction. You're headed towards a solid place. You have to apply that, folks, to your life. And that means that once you've been faithful in the small thing, once you begin to master one thing and you say, I got this down pat, don't think for a moment after that mastering one thing that you're not going to have a void. Feeling like you're just walking on air, not feeling like there's anything solid underneath you. That's reality. That's what happens with everything. My hands don't always have something solid within it. If I'm gripping something, let's say if I'm driving on a steering wheel and my hand is gripping the steering wheel, then it's grabbing something. It's holding on to something. But most of the time when I walk, my hands don't have anything in it, right? And so you don't always have to feel like you're holding something. You don't always have to feel like my foot is grounded on something. Most of the time, you just have to get to the place where you're understanding and realizing, here's the truth. I have more faith in my life that's between the steps where my hands are empty. I have more faith where these things happen. I have faith that when I go to bed, I'm going to wake up in the morning. Think about that. I never lay down and say, God, in heaven, please let me wake up in the morning. What if I don't wake up? What if I just die during the night? I mean, most people don't do that unless you really got some issues. Most of the time we're like, oh, I'm exhausted. I can't wait to go to sleep. But yet, think about by faith, how powerful of a faith level you have just by going to sleep. I mean, do you really know what happens to you? Do you realize you're out of control? Think about this. When you're asleep, your sensories really are, your eyes shut, your ears are closed. I mean, pretty much. So if you think about it, you're not even responsive on the outside of you. Someone could be standing over your bed. Now, I'm not trying to, put fear in you guys, but someone could be standing right over you in bed. Someone could reach down and choke you, and all of a sudden, you as you're waking up, you're grasping for air, right? So if you think about it, even going to sleep is a huge faith step because you can't even see. You're literally trusting. You are 100% trusting your environment around you that nothing's going to happen to you while you sleep, right? And so think about the power of faith that you have. So within my friend yesterday, we're talking about it, my client, and I mentioned to her, I said, let me explain something to you. You're talking about thoughts, but yet you never stop to realize the fact that God is going to get you in a place where you've mastered the small things. Now you're in the place of void where God is saying, here's the deal. You might not feel like anything's going on around you. That's because you're being upgraded. You're being upgraded to pay attention to the detail of your life, which means that now I'm going to challenge you in your whole beingness. I'm going to challenge you in becoming the very thing you're wanting to manifest. I want to challenge you in every part of you becoming that, to where no longer it's just the mind that thinks, it's the whole body that thinks. But in order for the whole body to think and attract, your body has to be accepted by you. Your life has to be accepted and loved by you. So what that means is this, you know, if God died to give me life, life more abundantly, how come I'm not loving the life He gave me? How do I know I'm not loving the life He gave me? If I was to ask you, like I asked my client yesterday, and don't even think about it, folks, I don't want you, any of you, to think about it, and don't try to over-spiritualize it. Don't try to throw in a Christian answer. Don't try to throw in a positive answer. If you do, you're lying to yourself. All right. You're not lying to me because I can't hear you. Okay. Because this is a podcast. But you're going to be lying to yourself. So if I was to ask you within a split second, number one, do you like yourself? What would it be? My friend said, not really. I said, second question. If you were naked in front of a mirror, do you like what you see? Real quick. Not really. Okay, number three. You know, do you think you find yourself attractive? Like within a millisecond, tell me, do you think people would look at you and pierce their eyes towards you? Would guys and others give you a second glance because you think you're beautiful? Not at all. I said, let me ask you a question. Why don't you realize now why you're not attracting anything? You know why? Because life that God's given you, life sometimes can be treated like a person. When you look at life and you realize, you know what? The very thing He's tried to give me, I don't like. So if I say, I don't like my life, I don't like my job, I don't like how I look, you know, then what happens here is, guess what? Life, quote unquote, life is going to look at you and say, you don't like me. You think you're ugly. You don't like your job. You don't like your house. So you don't like me. And all these things about your entire existence, the style of your life, every moment of every day, comes from life. That's why we call it a lifestyle. So if Jesus died to give us life, life more abundantly, then if you don't like life, then life is going to look at you and say, you don't even like me. Why should I give you the desires of your heart? Why should I even bring and attract like a magnet things into your life when you don't even like me? Think about that, folks, because you have to begin to look in the mirror, take a deep, hard look and say, you know what? Do I love life? Do I love life? Life has nothing to do with the beautiful home I live in, the beautiful car I drive. Let me tell you something. I drive an awesome, beautiful Jaguar. I love my car. I have a beautiful, gorgeous two-story home, extremely modern. Love it. But you know what? I didn't have that forever. I haven't had that, you know, since I was 3 years old or anything. And what I'm saying is this, is there's a point where I had to work my rear end off. I had to work really hard, but I also had to begin to be creative. I had to be the Son of God under the power of the Son of God and begin to create, master my thoughts. But more importantly, I had to come to a place in my life where, Jeremy, I love life. I love my life. And life had nothing to do, you know, with my car or home, because I didn't have those for a long time at all. Life was not about that. Life was the fact that I actually loved my life. Now, you might say, well, didn't Jesus say, you know, not to love your life, you know, to give your life away? Let me explain something to you. That's a different thing. What that means as far as loving your life, that means it doesn't mean you can't love the life God's given you. And you have gratitude and thankfulness in a humble way. That's not what God's talking about. Because you should be humble and grateful and thankful, you know, for the life He's decided to give you and love life that way. What He's talking about when He says, you know, loving not your life, you know, what it means for you is it basically saying this to you. Don't love life in the sense of all your materialism. Don't like all the things you have. I don't say, oh, God, I love my life because of. Oh, I love my life because of, you know, I'm at a perfect weight. Oh, because of my clothes. Oh, I love life because of my home. That's what Jesus is talking about. Because all these things are going to pass away. Who cares? These things are going to pass away one day, you know? And it could walk out of my life today or tomorrow. But the truth is, I will continue to attract the beautiful things of life because of the fact I love life. Because I love the one who gave me the life, and I love the very thing. Here's what I've learned in my life, okay? And that is this. I love the one who gave me the life, and I love the life that He gave me. Because once you begin to understand that, that's a good tweet for many of you guys. I love the one who gave me life, and I love the life that He gave me. Because I love everything on what my father started to give me. And because of that, this woman began to really have an eye-opening experience. She began to realize, wait a minute, you're right. That's right. I've missed it. I said, yeah. I said, because every time you say I look ugly, I look fat, I'm you know, guys don't look at me, girls don't look at me, no one gives me the time of day, you know, but yet my thoughts are so positive. I'm going to attract a beautiful career. I'm going to attract a beautiful job. I'm going to attract a beautiful car. And I'm going to, you know, guess what? Life's going to say, I can't deliver that to you because you don't even like me. And so, guess what you're doing? You are deflecting. And here's what the Bible says about that. It's called a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Why are you unstable? Because you haven't built the groundwork where you understand the processes of God. That yes, your mind is being renewed and renewing itself every day by the mind of Christ. Yes. But also, you're not allowing the voids, the empty spaces of your life that will come between every stage of your life. You're not welcoming those. You're too busy freaking out thinking, oh God, I've done something wrong. Oh God, where are you? What's going on? What, have I sinned? And God's like, my goodness gracious, why do you always have to go to the negative? Why can't you just be positive for once and truly claim what you believe you're doing as far as being positive and just say, maybe it's time for an upgrade. If I see the things of my old life and all the things I've attracted or my positive thoughts or if I've seen my things in my life fading away, that's a good thing. Maybe I'm being upgraded. Maybe God is saying I gotta take away the old, establish the new. That's what His Word says. And so you gotta begin to run with that and realize, you know what, hold on a minute. You know, I need to welcome the empty spaces. And the empty spaces between me is taking a step to the next step, I need to welcome those empty spaces. What that's guaranteeing me is you are no longer on the first step. You haven't made the second step yet, but you need to welcome the air that your foot is in at the moment. You need to welcome the faith level that you are right now. And that faith will require that things are ripped out from underneath your feet. Why? You've already mastered the small things. You've already crossed the finish line of the small things. Why do you think God's going to continue to give you trophies of a line you've already crossed? Come on, folks. Rewards don't come from the lines you constantly you cross and then cross it again and cross it again. I guess the reward is in His hand because you begin to cross every season new finish lines you've never crossed before. If you're crossing the same finish line over and over again, something is wrong with you. Sorry, folks, but something's really wrong with the situation here, okay? And so you got to begin to realize that. And so it altered her life because I said, and let me put it to another way. I said, in other words, God honored your first step of thinking positive, attracting things by the power of your thoughts, you know, pulling the positivity in there. And your mind was starting to be renewed and it's renewing by the mind of Christ every day. And God honored that. However, that should be part of your foundation laying of your groundwork. However, there's other groundwork now that's going to be more imperatively important, which is going to be the deeper side of you, which is actually the fullness of who you are. That way, the fullness of you can truly be the magnet and attract, we could say maybe larger things. Maybe we could say better things. Maybe you can attract now deeper things. But see, you can't expect to attract the deeper, larger, valued things of life until you first dive deep and allow yourself to see yourself in the mirror, take a deep hard look at your life, and say, I give gratitude for everything. Here's the thing. If you feel like you are just ugly, now I don't like the word fat. I can't stand the word fat. I think it's just disrespectful. But I'm going to use it just for a moment as if you're the one thinking it. If you look and you say, Jeremy, I am fat. I am ugly. My nose is large. My hair is just greasy or it's long, whatever the case may be. Let me tell you something. Then if that's who you are, then guess what? Congratulations. You know why? Because you're at the perfect stage for God to begin to say, good, you've come to a place of great acknowledgement. Now that you have acknowledged, now that you have truly acknowledged, you have truly acknowledged your worldly, natural, humanistic reality, now we can change that. The first step, what do they say in AA, folks? That is now called. The first step, what? Is admittance. You've admitted it. You have faced the reality of the world, of how the world has told you to view yourself. Congratulations. That's your first step. Your second step now is now renouncing all that by learning to love the person you are. Doesn't mean you're probably, you know, here's the thing. Do you still want to lose weight? Sure you do. Hey, if you want a nose job, hey, go for it. I'm not against that at all, okay? What I'm saying is this, though. In the process, in the time that you are thinking positive, you can still say, you know what? my body's made the image and likeness of God. Maybe he didn't create me to be maybe overweight, but you know what? He loves me regardless and still finds me beautiful. And maybe I've maybe gained some weight from overeating. Maybe I've gained weight because of a medical problem. Maybe I've gained weight for something. But you know what? I'm still loving me because I'm still made in the image of God. And let me tell you something, folks. Whether you are overweight or you are skinny, now, if you are white or you're black, or you have no hair or you have tons of hair, or you have a big nose or a crooked ear, let me tell you something. You are still made in the image of God. There's not an image where you say, I need to get back to the image of God because I'm now no longer in his image. No, you're made. You're beautiful right now as you are, as you are. And once you begin to accept that, then that self-love will help you and empower you more to say, now that I really love me and I love everything that God has given me in my life, not things, but in my life, then you know what your body's going to do? You mark my word, folks. You will begin to lose the weight that you wanted to lose in the very beginning. Why? Because self-love helps our body to be able to do what it needs to do to maybe correct itself, adjust itself, or get where it needs to be. When people say, man, I eat a lot when I'm unhappy. Well, duh. Can you see why? Because you're giving your body hatred. And so therefore, you're not going to attract anything beautiful into your life. Beauty is the power of your acceptance. And once you do that, and God will challenge you on that. Once you do that, you'll start getting the sales like my client did. You'll start attracting bigger things in your life that you need. That's the kingdom of God. So folks, thank you so much for tuning into our podcast. I welcome every one of you, you know, to be able to always speak, you know, speak to us. Let us know how you like the podcast, maybe what future things you want to hear on by just letting us know by writing into customerservice@identitynetwork.net. Customerservice@identitynetwork.net. And when you do, you know what, let us know what you like about the podcast. And by the way, if you really want to know more books on these subjects, I'm going to tell you this. Go to the website, identitynetwork.net. Okay. And I would say order the combo of my book called Synchronicities. This book and study guide will revolutionize your life in the sense of understanding the patterns of God. I also have a course called the School of Law of Attraction that has changed thousands of people's lives. I go into in-depth stuff when it deals with the School of Law of Attraction. And that would begin to really help every one of you to know the power that's beyond just, hey, I'm thinking, and I'm attracting. No, I'm going to teach you how to attract by your whole being. That's going to make a difference more than anything of your thoughts. That's going to be able to withstand the time of pain and pressure and testings in your life. Because when you attract things by your beingness, folks, you're attracting some serious groundwork in your life. All right? So don't forget to do that. And as always on our podcast, don't forget today, go and create the life you want. Your thoughts and your mind are powerful. Your heart is powerful. Create the life that you know God wants you to have through his will for your life. Take that paintbrush and paint some beautiful color, and which is creativity, within your life today. God bless you.
This has been the Thoughts Become Things podcast with Jeremy Lopez, helping you reach your highest creative potential that God has for you. For more episodes, products, and information on Jeremy, visit www.identitynetwork.net.